إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ألا إن أولياء
to him, to whom belongs all infinite might, infinite power, and infinite strength. The dominion of the heavens and the earth belong to him. May his choices of salutations and blessings be upon our beloved master, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, first and foremost, I would like to enjoin upon myself and all of you seated here to adopt a life of taqwa, a life which is filled with the fear of Almighty Allah, the consciousness of Almighty Allah. For my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is only through the taqwa of Allah, it is only by adopting a life of taqwa can an individual attain success in this world and the hereafter. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازًا, that indeed for the people of taqwa is success, is victory in this world and the hereafter. For my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is only through the taqwa of Allah, the fear of Allah, the consciousness of Allah, can we attain the love of Allah, can we attain the wilayah. It is only through taqwa that we become the awliya of Allah. As the ayah that I recited in the beginning, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ, that indeed the awliya of Allah, they have nothing to fear about, they have nothing to worry about. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to describe them, they are the ones who have believed, they are the ones who have brought in iman, وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ, and they are the ones who used to fear Almighty Allah, they are the ones who used to be conscious of Allah the Almighty. لَهُمُ الْبُشْرَى فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ, and for them is glad tidings in this world and the hereafter. Success in this world and the hereafter. لا تبديل لكلمات الله. And the words of Allah جل وعز. The words of Allah the Almighty do not change. The decree of Allah the Almighty does not change. ذلك هو الفوز العظيم. And that is indeed a great success for them. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, a question that we need to ask ourselves is, are we the friends of Allah or are we the friends of Shaytan? Are we the friends of Allah or are we the friends of Shaytan? As the very next ayah that I recited, وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذِ الشَّيْطَانَ وَلِيًّا مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُّبِينًا. As for those who take Shaytan as their friend, leaving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُّبِينًا. Indeed, they have sustained a very clear loss. A loss irreplaceable. They have sustained a loss in this world and the hereafter. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to the term wilaya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses it in the noble Quran, the first ayah, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَا اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَا. And then وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذْ وَلِيَّا. All of these words stem from the root al-wilaya. So what is the meaning of wilaya? Al-wilaya is the exact opposite of al-adawa. Al-wilaya means love or closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as for al-adawa, it is hatred, it is animosity, it is being distant from someone. So this is the meaning of these two words. So how can an individual attain al-wilaya, attain wilaya towards Allah the Almighty? Attain the love of Allah the Almighty. Attain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can an individual achieve this? My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the two primary conditions of wilaya is taqwa, as I mentioned in the beginning. And then the next is to believe in all that which our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. To believe in every single thing. And also to follow him inwardly and outwardly. To follow our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam completely. To believe in him completely and to follow him completely. And that is the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, he mentioned that there are people who claim to love Allah. They claim that they are the awliya of Allah. They claim to love Allah. So Allah the Almighty revealed a verse from the noble Quran in order to test these people. And what was that verse, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? Allah the Almighty, he says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say unto the people, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ, if you love Allah the Almighty, فَاتَّبِعُونِي. If you love Allah, then follow me. Follow me completely. Follow my sunnah. Adopt my lifestyle as your lifestyle. Follow me as a role model. يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ. And then indeed Allah the Almighty, he will love you. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. And he will forgive all of your sins. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this is the importance of the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A famous hadith which is recorded
in Abu Dawud, Al-Miqdam ibn Ma'di Karim radiyallahu anhu, he narrates the hadith. He says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوْتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that indeed I have been given the Qur'an and something similar to it. I have been given the Qur'an and something similar to it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is referring to his sunnah, to his tradition. I have been given the Qur'an and I have also been given the sunnah. And the hadith goes along the lines of these words afterwards. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then goes on to say, but then later on a nation will come, a group of people will come, who will recline on their sofas, who will recline on their couches, and they will say, عَلَيْكُمْ بِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ فَمَا وَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ حَلَالٍ فَأَحِلُّوهُ فَمَا وَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ حَرَامٍ فَحَرِّمُوهُ. They will say, suffice yourself with the Qur'an only. Suffice yourself with the Qur'an only. Whatever the Qur'an has only made haram, make it haram. Whatever the Qur'an has only made halal, make it halal. We do not need the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, a thing to be noted, a very important point is that the Qur'an and the sunnah go hand in hand. The Qur'an and the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go hand in hand. And when I say sunnah, do I mean the beard of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Do I mean the turban of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Rather, it is a much broader spectrum term, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It covers many aspects, of which are al-aqwal, the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-af'al, the actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-iqrar, the approvals of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and one more category which many people are not aware of, sunnah al-tarkiyah, the sunnahs which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left. Just as he left those sunnahs, we too leave them. For example, we have adhan for 5 times salawat, for the 5 times prayers. But do we have adhan for salatul eid? Do we have adhan for the solar or the lunar eclipse prayers? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have left the adhan in those circumstances. So due to him leaving, we too leave this sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now coming back to the first three categories, as for the aqwal, the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they encompass the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And alhamdulillah, it is through the grace of Allah the Almighty that the Sahaba, Allah the Almighty, He used the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. He used the scholars of Islam to preserve these sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no other religion on the face of this earth that can claim that we have the statements of our leaders, or we have the statements of our prophets protected, just as how you and I in our religion we have it, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. As for the af'al, the actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this too has been reported to us through the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, just as how they witnessed our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing those actions, they have narrated it to us. And as for the approvals of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a good example to clarify it, as examples bring about clarity, there was once an instance when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was at a table, was at a feast. Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu was next to him. A dish was served to the table. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stretches his hand, his blessed hand, to partake of that dish. Immediately it was told to him, Ya Rasulullah, this is the meat of a dhab. In other words, it is the meat of a type of a reptile, a type of a lizard. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately withdrew his hand back. Now Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu, on the other hand, who was next to him, he was used to eating this meat. It was a delicacy according to him. So he immediately asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, is it haram for me to partake of it? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quietly replied that no, it is not haram. But the people of my tribe, of my locality, of my area are not used to eating this type of a meat. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not partake of that meat. But Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu, on the other hand, he took the dish forward and he completed the meal. He completed the meal. So due to that, my dear respect, the elders and brothers in Islam, scholars of Islam, they mentioned that this was one of the instances where the approval of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For indeed, if that meat was haram, if it was forbidden, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would never have kept quiet whilst Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu was partaking of the meal. He would have immediately stopped him. Him keeping quiet about it, even though he did not partake of the meal, proves that he approved of that action. So due to that, it is halal for us also to partake of such types of meat. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to what I said in the beginning, that the Quran and the Sunnah go hand in hand, as now we have understood to some extent what Sunnah covers. In regard to the Quran and the Sunnah going hand in hand, scholars mention that Sunnah, it divides into another few categories on a different platform. For example, As-Sunnah tubayyinu al-mujmal, As-Sunnah tuqayyidu al-mutlaq, As-Sunnah tukhassisu al-aam. I do not have the time to go into each of these, as I would need two or three lectures to cover it. But to give you a brief summary of what I'm trying to prove, for example, if you take the ayah, السارق والسارقة فقطعوا أيديهما جزاء بما كسبا نكالا من الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the thief, whether he be male or female, the punishment for robbery, for theft, cut his hands off, chop his hands off. السنه تبين المجمل. Now the ayah is very concise. It is very concise. So if you were to ask, or if the question were to arise, now where do we cut the individual's hand off from? Where do we cut it off from? If we were to ask someone, he would say, okay, cut it off from the wrist. Another person would say, cut it off from the elbow. Another person would say, cut it off from the forearm. So like this, many views would come about. So such a concise ayah, we refer to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where it comes in beautifully and explains and defines to us what is concise, what is mujmal, and from that we can derive rulings. Likewise, if we were to take the ayah, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالْدَمْ, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all dead animals have been made haram upon you. Likewise, all types of blood are haram upon the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now my question to you is, what about fish? What about fish? The minute you take it out from the water, it is a dead animal. So does that mean that you have to take it out and before it dies you slaughter it? The Quran ayah says, all types of dead animals are haram upon you. So the people who suffice themselves with only the Quran, fish is haram for them. But then the sunnah, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes in, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that two dead animals have been made halal for you. Likewise, two types of blood have been made halal for you. What are these two dead animals? As-samak wal-jarad, fish and locusts. Locusts are a type of a grasshopper found in the Arab region. It does not have flowing blood, and there are seasons when it comes and swarms around the Kaaba. The Arabs of those days had the habit of drying the locust and using it for provision. And it is halal in Islam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explains that even though the ayah mentions dead animals in whole, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now comes in and exempts these two animals out. Likewise, dumb blood completely is haram. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, two types of blood are halal. What are they? Rasulullah goes on to define the liver and the spleen. Now the liver, all of us know that the liver consists of 90-95% of blood. It is a part of the body of an animal which consists of 90-95% of blood. Likewise the spleen. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes in and beautifully exempts these four things. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the people who try to suffice themselves with the Quran only, an easy question to them is, if they can they bring proof? Can they bring evidence to prove that Isha Salah is four raka'at? Anywhere from the Quran, one verse from the Noble Quran, that Isha Salah is four raka'at, or Dhuhr Salah is four raka'at, or you have to make ruku' like this, or sajda like this. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith, the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name, it is that which comes in and beautifully teaches us, beautifully explains to us how we have to make salah. Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray like how you have seen me pray. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So why I mentioned this in the beginning, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, to prove something. In regard to aql and naql, when we say aql, what we mean here is logic or reasoning. And naql, on the other hand, is the text of the Quran and the text of the Sunnah. As we have defined that the need for the two are compulsory and that they go hand in hand. Now we do not negate that there is a necessity for logic and reason. But remember, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that every single aspect of deen, of the deen of Allah the Almighty, does not work according to each individual's logic and reason. For if it were to work like that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the deen of Allah the Almighty would have become a toy. It would have become a toy in each person's hands. Each person would act upon the deen the way his fancies and his whims and desires go. The deen of Allah, the Almighty, does not work according to our logic and reason, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. A good example to prove that, Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam, he was commanded to slaughter his son. Does that sound logical in any way to you? Does that sound logical? Today we have people saying, why do we have to cover? Why do women have to cover? What is the reason behind it? What is the logic behind it? Everything does not work according to your logic and reasoning, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. If we are talking about women covering, then what about Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam being commanded to slaughter his son? In what way would it benefit him, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? But it was a command of Allah. It was a command of Allah. And he did not know that it was Allah testing him or testing his obedience. We know the story. He goes ahead and even starts running the knife upon his son's neck. In total compliance to the order of Allah the Almighty. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to aql and naql, there are things in the deen. There are things in the deen where we have to believe. That's what I said. If you want to become from the awliya of Allah, if you want to become from the awliya of Allah and not from the awliya of shaytan, then you have to believe in every single thing that our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. And likewise, you need to follow his sunnah completely, inwardly and outwardly. And that would lead to success in this world and the hereafter. Allah the Almighty, he says in the Noble Quran,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who have brought in Iman, O you who have believed in Allah the Almighty. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, whenever Allah the Almighty addresses us in the Quran as Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, you have to sit upright and listen to the words of Allah the Almighty attentively. So the reason being, we haven't been brought in Iman, don't we call ourselves mu'minun? Then Allah is addressing us, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who have brought in Iman, O you who have believed in Allah the Almighty, ati'u Allah, obey Allah, comply to the commandments of Allah the Almighty, wa ati'u Rasul, likewise, obey the Messenger of Allah the Almighty. Obey the Messenger of Allah the Almighty. Adopt his lifestyle as your lifestyle. Believe in every single thing that he has come with. Wa ulil amri minkum. Likewise, obey the ones who have authority amongst you. Fa in tanaza'tum fi shay'in. And if you ever dispute in a matter, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ, then refer back to Allah and His Messenger. And what Allah the Almighty means here, scholars of Tafsir mention, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ, go back to the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Refer back to the Qur'an and the Sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ, and that is if you believe in Allah, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and if you believe in the last day, if you believe in the day of Qiyamah, if you believe in the day of judgment. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the day of Qiyamah is an impending reality. It is about to hit all of us very soon. The signs of Qiyamah are taking place one after the other. The world is heading towards its destruction. إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, if you believe in Allah and if you believe in the day of Qiyamah. As for when the day of Qiyamah is going to take place, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, none has the knowledge in regard to that. Allah the Almighty, He says in the Noble Quran, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا قُلْ إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي لَا يُجَلِّيهَا لِوَقْتِهَا إِلَّا هُوَ ثَقُلَتْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَا تَأْتِيكُمْ إِلَّا بَغْتًا. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا, O Rasulullah, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they ask you about when the day of Qiyamah is going to take place. Inform them that knowledge is only with Allah the Almighty. لَا يُجَلِّيهَا لِوَقْتِهَا إِلَّا هُوَ, and none can make i'lan, none can inform us of that information other than Allah the Almighty. ثَقُلَتْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, but that matter in regard to the day of Qiyamah has become a matter of great importance in the heavens and in the earth. لَا تَأْتِيكُمْ إِلَّا بَغْتًا, but no one thing for sure, that the day of Qiyamah will take you all suddenly, will grip you all suddenly, will take hold of you all suddenly. Allahu Akbar. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, as Allah says in another place, إِنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَآتِيَةٌ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا, that indeed the day of Qiyamah is on its way. It is on its way. It is on its way, لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا, there is no doubt in that. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, but most of mankind do not believe in it. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, بُعِثْتُ أَنَا وَالسَّاعَتُكَ هَاتَيْنِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that indeed I and the day of Qiyamah have been sent like this. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointed to his two fingers in this manner to indicate the proximity of the sending of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a prophet, as the final messenger, and the day of Qiyamah, to indicate the proximity, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Even though Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not informed as to when exactly the day of Qiyamah would take place, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was educated in regard to the signs of the day of Qiyamah. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the signs of the day of Qiyamah, alamatu sa'a, divide themselves into two. Alamatu sa'ati sughra, alamatu sa'ati al-kubra. The minor signs of the day of judgment and the major signs of the day of judgment. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, beware that the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, most of them, 90% of them have already taken place, have already occurred. There is no doubt in regard to that. Some of them are such as adultery, fornication will begin to take place all over the world, everywhere. Homosexuality will become something of a fad. Musical instruments will be common all over the place. Consumption of wine will take place everywhere. All of these signs, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the list is endless, but all of them are taking place right in front of our eyes. Allah save this ummah. Now as for the major signs of the day of Qiyamah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, as for the major signs, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith is in Muslim, Abu Hudayfa ibn Asid al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu, he narrates the hadith, that once there was a gathering of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een. They were talking. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes to the gathering. He comes to the gathering. He asks the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een, O my Sahaba, what are you all discussing about? What are you all talking about? They reply, Ya Rasulullah, we are discussing about the Akhirah. We are discussing about the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. Just think, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, in every instance of their lives, their heart was connected to the Akhirah. Their hearts were connected to the Akhirah, for they knew that this worldly life is nothing but a transitory stage. It is temporary. Their abode, their destination is Al-Akhirah. This place is a place to prepare yourself for Akhirah, for a life of eternity. So they informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we are discussing about the day of judgment. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, لا تقوم ساعة حتى تكون عشر آيات. That indeed the day of Qiyamah will not come upon you all until 10 major signs occur. Until 10 major signs take place. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then goes on to mention these signs. You can count the signs with me, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. These are the major signs. Number one, ad-dukhan. A foggy smoke would fill the planet. It would fill the whole earth, resulting in the believers developing a cold. And they would later on pass away due to that sickness. And due to that foggy smoke, the unbelievers, the kuffar, would fall unconscious. The next is ad-dajjal. Al-Masih ad-dajjal. Number three, the sun rising from the west. Number four, the dissension of Isa ibn Maryam, Isa alayhi salam. Number five, Khuruj Ya'juj wa Ma'juj, the appearing or the emerging of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Gog and Magog. And next would be a major earthquake. Now, earthquakes taking place all over the world is from the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. This, I'm talking about a mega earthquake. A huge earthquake taking place in the west, another mega earthquake taking place in the east, and another mega earthquake taking place in the lands of Arabia. And finally, a fire would break out from Yemen, which would gather all of the believers to a place where the day of Qiyamah would start afterwards, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. But now the sequence, the order that I mentioned, in other hadiths, the order varies. So due to that, the scholars of Islam have come to a conclusion, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the sequence that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in this very hadith is not the sequence of the signs of the day of Qiyamah. Imam ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he mentions that the first of the major signs to take place would be the emerging of Dajjal. And in another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that in regard to the signs of the day of Qiyamah, they are like a necklace. a necklace with beads. For even if one of those beads were to break off, the rest of those beads would fall one after the other consecutively. Likewise, even if one of these major signs takes place, the remaining nine would occur consecutively one after the other rapidly, very rapidly. So Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he mentions that the very first sign to take place from the major signs would be the emerging of Dajjal. And Dajjal, the emerging of Dajjal, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Rasulullah s.a.w. is reported to have said that there is no trial greater than the trial of Dajjal from the creation of Adam a.s. until the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. No greater trial than the emerging of Dajjal. And when he comes out, things would begin to change very rapidly on the face of this earth. Very major changes will begin to take place until Isa alayhi salatu wasalam descends. And likewise, the sun rising from the west, that sign would indicate major changes in the heavens amongst the celestial objects. And those changes would only cease when the dabba, when the animal comes out. This is another one of the major signs which concludes all 10 of the major signs. So my dear respected elder, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to Dajjal, one of the signs to indicate the proximity of the emerging of Dajjal is that, this is according to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Dajjal, the mention of Dajjal would cease amongst the scholars. Dajjal would not be mentioned on the manabir, on the pulpits, in their sermons. My question to you is, when was the last time you heard about Dajjal? When the mention of Dajjal reduces, when people start forgetting about Dajjal, that would be the time when Dajjal comes out, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And in regard to Dajjal, a very important point to be noted is that Dajjal is not some kind of a symbol of evil. He is not a metaphor. He is not a figurative expression of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there are many ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that describes Dajjal in a great detail. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described Dajjal, hadith in Muslim, where he says that Dajjal would be a youngster who will be hunched. He will have a very prominent and protruding forehead, upon which Kaf, Fa, Ra, three letters will be written. And that word, Kafir, the literate and the illiterate of the believers would be able to read that word. As long as they have Iman, as long as they have brought in the Iman of Allah the Almighty, they would be able to read that word on the Dajjal's forehead. Likewise, his two eyes. In regard to his two eyes, both of them will be defective. One eye will be as if it has been wiped off, Al-Mamsur. And that is the reason he is known as Al-Masih Al-Dajjal. And the other eye would be like a protruding grape, a grapefruit floating in his socket. His complexion would be a reddish white complexion. He would be short, stout and powerfully built. He will have a wide neck. He will have a wide neck, and his hair would be thick, curly locks that would fall on his shoulders, and it would look as if snakes were intertwining on one another. His walk would be as if his feet were set apart. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also used to refer to him as Al-A'war. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the very same hadith, he went on to say that Dajjal, he is Al-A'war, and your Lord, Allah the Almighty, he is not Al-A'war. The meaning of A'war is that he would be blind in one eye. Allah the Almighty is not blind in one eye, but Dajjal would be blind in one eye. And once again I repeat, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that there will be no greater trial than the trial of Dajjal, than the fitna of Dajjal, from the very creation of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam until the day of Qiyamah. May Almighty Allah save this ummah. And the only way we would be able to distinguish Dajjal, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is if we have the knowledge in regard to it. Because he would be an overcoming individual. He would have many powers. where he would cause miracles to take place. And this is all according to the will of Allah the Almighty, as a fitna, as a trial to test this ummah. He would make the heavens open and the rains fall. He would bring out treasures from the earth. He would have Jannah and Jahannam in his two hands, but in reality, his Jannah will be Jahannam and his Jahannam will be Jannah. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, due to the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, describing Dajjal in such a great detail, we cannot consider Dajjal to be a symbol of evil or a metaphor for that matter. Some people say that the television is Dajjal. Some people say that the World Wide Web is Dajjal. How can a television have two eyes, an eye which would look like a protruding grape? How can a television have curly locks of hair? How can a television be stout and powerfully built? Likewise, how could we assimilate these descriptions to the World Wide Web? No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he is an individual. He is from the children of Adam, alayhi salatu wassalam. No one knows about his parents. He could be a bastard, born out of fornication, but currently he is alive. According to the hadith of Tamimun al-Dari radiallahu anhu, the very famous hadith, Hadith al-Jassasa, which is recorded in Sahih Muslim, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawud, he is currently alive in an island where nobody knows. Tamimun al-Dari radiallahu anhu, he met him. He spoke to Dajjal. He came and informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dajjal is in shackles, in chains. He is waiting for the decree of Allah for him to come out and cause all kinds of corruption. So he is alive, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in an island where no one knows. He is waiting for the decree of Allah to come out. And in that very hadith, he mentions many things where my emerging, my coming out is very soon. I am going to come out very soon. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the only thing that would save you from the fitna of Dajjal is Iman and the taqwa of Allah the Almighty. And that is why I highlighted these two aspects in the very beginning of the khutbah that would win you the wilaya of Allah, the love of Allah, the closeness of Allah. For only if you have Iman in your heart, you don't need an Oxford degree. You don't need to be literate to read the word kafir written on his forehead. The only criteria that would help you to read those words would be your Iman. Would be the Iman of Allah in your heart. If you have Iman, if you are a believer, you would be able to differentiate from Dajjal and save yourself. And two things, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that if one memorizes the first 10 verses of Suratul Kahf, the first 10 verses, and recites it often, that would save him from the trials of Dajjal. Likewise, the dua which you recite in your 5-time salawat, Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min adhabil qabr wa min adhabil nahar wa min fitnatil mahya wal mamat wa min fitnatil masih al-dajjal. This dua, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, would save you from the fitna of Dajjal. So my advice to you is to try and memorize these 10 verses, the first 10 verses of Suratul Kahf, and if possible, try to memorize the whole surah, as it has a very distinct relationship to this very noble day, Friday. Memorize the surah, recite it often, as that would save you from the fitna of Dajjal. May Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save this complete ummah from the fitna of Dajjal. May He forgive all of our sins and accept all of our good deeds. And may Allah the Almighty unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah. Wa